I'm excited to welcome you. My name is Hunt Allcott. The other panelists here are, in order, going to be Josh Wright. Stefan Hunt is next, and then Mariana Laughlin. And I will present last. Everybody's going to present for about 12 minutes, some thoughts they have based on their expert experience scaling up behaviorally motivated programs. And then we're going to have questions and discussion after that, at which point the four panelists will come up here. Josh, take it away.
Thank you, Hunt. I think this session is very apropos given the conversation this morning about sort of moving beyond nudges. So I think there's kind of two components to scaling around taking the nudges and actually making them so they're not just one-off experimental nudges, but also moving into bigger areas. Okay, so behavioral science innovations are different. This is one of my favorite books for my three-year-old, Big Orange Splot. And they're predominantly different just because we have a way of looking at the world differently, right? So we look at it from a different angle and we come up with different solutions. Now, for the most part, actually, scaling behavioral ideas is not different from other innovations. And that's because a lot of it just has to do with hard work. The reality is most of the efforts to get things to scale are going to take a lot of work. And I'll talk actually a little bit later about the 401k example, which we all know very well, and the 18 years of work that went into that to get us to even a 15% adoption rate. But you also have to have a path to scale. And we'll return to this later, just thinking through what are the plausible paths to scale. We have five that we've come up with. I'm not sure that it's exhaustive yet. I think we're still early in the development of the field. Now, there is one thing that I think we do have to think about a little bit differently when you're talking about scaling behavioral interventions, and that is the diagnosis or what's causing the bottleneck. This is here, you know, a picture of doctors, but this is really the way we should think about figuring out what the problem is, like what's actually going on, what's the bottleneck or mechanism getting in the way. And the reason we have to care about that so much is because the context matters so much. This is the famous story of the B17, which many of you may have heard already, which is really about this idea that context that the pilots are operating in matters so much. Alphonse Chapanis corrected this problem of pilots raising the landing gear in this very expensive aircraft during World War II, crashing to the ground by simply changing the knobs of the landing gear and the flaps. One got a triangular handle and one got a circular handle, and the problem basically went away. So the context matters so much, right? So we know that defaults and savings can be quite powerful. I'm not going to go into the details of this. You know this very well. 401k defaults, it works. Now, interestingly, some researchers tried to do this with low-income people at tax time to try to get them to save their earned income tax credit, defaulting them 10% into a savings bond. Interestingly, opt-in and opt-out were exactly the same. Right, so you're saying, well, what's going on here? It all has to do with the context. What's the psychology of the 401k? Out of every 100 employees, you ask 68% self-report spending too little. 24 plan to raise their savings in the next 2 months. And then when you look at the administrative data, only 3% do. Right, so then what's the psychology going on with the ITC? They actually went back to low-income tax filers, and people could answer yes to more than one of these questions. The number one issue was that people already had a plan for how they were going to spend the money when they arrived at the tax site. So in the first case, the 401k, it's a problem. The context is really driving a problem of hassles, procrastination. There's an intention-action gap. Here, there's not an intention-action gap. There's actually an intention problem. People don't have the intention to save. So you'd have to do something totally different to actually be effective. Now, that's pretty stark, right? You say, like, well, Josh, those contexts are quite different. That's pretty obvious. Now think about this context, right? So we've done a lot of work in college completion. Social belonging and college persistence is actually, by the work we've done, and I'll show you the graphs in a second, but also some work that Jeff Cohen has done, has shown to be effective. But it's also not always universally effective. It's effective by some subgroups. And you can also imagine that colleges could be quite different. Like Jeff did a lot of his work at the University of Texas. This is at San Francisco State University. Is it going to be true for two-year institutions as it is for four? Is there some dynamic depending on how prestigious the university is, how heavily there's commuter students or not commuter students, right? So the college context could seem the same, but it actually could be quite detailed. And so this impact that you see around at San Francisco State University around students persisting and re-enrolling for the second year, and this is students at the university had already identified as high risk, and we're put into treatment and control groups. And we did a social belonging intervention with a video, and they wrote themselves social belonging and self-affirmations that got sent back to them in text messages. You can't be so sure that this is going to continue to work as you try to scale it up. And this is how we start to think about the two very high-level approaches to scale at the beginning. One is you can have like a bottoms-up approach. The way this usually works for us is we get funded by somebody, a foundation, a government, to do some work in an area. In this case, it was college completion. It could be about healthcare. You do a number of experiments. You work with partners to figure out what the behavioral problems are that they're seeing. And then you figure out what works. And then you go through the process of confirming and refining. The other approach would be you could have some moonshot that you wanted to achieve, like 90% screening rates for colorectal cancer. You'd come up with a behavioral intervention. You'd go find partners. You discover that something worked with that partner. But the key thing is, in this red oval there, is there's a lot of refinement that has to happen and retesting and making sure that it's going to work in multiple contexts. Now, there are some times where you should be less concerned about this issue, right? Where you don't have to worry about the diagnosis as much as you scale. And that's in situations where you have lots of darts, lots of opportunities. It's super low cost to throw the different darts. And you don't have to worry about things getting messed up operationally, right? So the classic example of this would be letters. This is a project that the Social and Behavioral Sciences team and Ideas 42 has lent people from the beginning to the Social and Behavioral Sciences team in the federal government, where they're just trying to get students who are in default or close to default to sign up for income-based repayments. And so they just adjust the emails. Now, they're now going back and scaling this up, sending it to lots of people who are suffering from the default problems and trying out lots of variations. And they actually don't have to spend a lot of time doing diagnosis because they can continually, they can be like Capital One with credit card statements or credit card offers. They can try out lots of different variations, and it's quite low cost. But this is not actually that often the case. I mean, we hear about a lot of opportunities in government where it's about changing emails or letters. But when you get into more details of government programs and private sector nonprofits and for-profits, it's not so often that you have this situation. So then you want to think a little bit more from the beginning about paths to scale. So these are the five paths that we've come up with. The first is a change in federal policy or state or large state policy. So the 401k is a great example of this. But other things could be like the asset policy. If you wanted low-income people to save more money, there's actually this problem where you can fall out of eligibility for benefits if you accumulate too many assets. So that's one area, and I'll go into a detailed example of each one of these. The next is this idea that sometimes scale can be baked in. We see this often in government entities, but it doesn't have to be government entities. If you think in the financial inclusion space or the health space, if you partner with a large for-profit sector player, if you get them to pilot something and it works, and then they do it with everybody that they're touching, that can often be millions of people. If you get JPMorgan Chase to change a product or do something differently, I don't know exactly how many customers they have, but it's tens of millions of customers. Or someone like the College Board is not a governmental entity. They administer the SAT. And then you can imagine that there's lots of opportunities based on that to send students information about filling out the financial aid forms or choosing a college. So that's the idea. And those two paths are in some way, I think, the easiest two paths. And that's often why we're drawn to government as a vehicle to try and scale ideas. But there's also a B2C strategy, which is when you're going to try and create something and go directly to the consumer. Now, I say here, build a business. That doesn't have to be a for-profit business. It could be a nonprofit. But it's the idea that you create some entity that's whole mission is to try to take that intervention directly to the consumer. And I would actually argue that you can argue about the social value of Facebook, but I would actually argue that Facebook is at heart a behavioral intervention and a behavioral company. But things like Dean Carlin's Stick or Even, which is a company that helps individuals manage variations in income level, so they kind of get a constant paycheck. Or Steve Wendell, who's here, formerly of Hello Wallet, now of Morningstar. Those are all situations where you're trying to create something to get it directly to lots of consumers. We actually think this is the most risky approach because there's actually a lot, often capital requirements. You need very talented people to build and start a new business. And going direct to consumer has its own risks in terms of getting adoption. The second is a B2B model, which is slightly less risky, but also still risky. And this is the idea that you're going to take those interventions and just make it super easy for whoever the players are that have the touch points with the consumer, and you're just going to do it for them. So I'll talk a little bit more about a suite of college completion services in a minute around that. And then the last one is simple replication, which is, I think, the way we often imagine that people are going to undertake, that scale is going to happen. That if we publish some great study, people are just going to be like, that is awesome, and everyone's just going to start doing it. And that very, very rarely happens. So replication requires a lot of communication, dissemination, and varying degrees of hand-holding with the people that you would want to replicate. So let's just run through quickly an example of this. The policy one is the 401k default history. I just wanted to put this slide up here because this is the reality. It's taken about 18 years. If you think back to when Mark Ivery at the Treasury Department wrote the first letter beginning to give companies the okay to do this sort of thing till 2013, when we were still only at 50% adoption rate. And we think of this as a huge success, and it has been a huge success, but it has taken a lot of time and effort, a lot of actually lobbying and advocacy work to get the regulations and the guidance correct. Okay, I've got 1 minute left, so I'm gonna be quick here. This is the idea of the scale baked in. This is a government situation where you're trying to get military members to save more for retirement. These are the studies, you can read about them in the Social and Behavioral Sciences report. But basically, each one of these, the military then has adopted and is rolling out globally to their millions of service members. A B2B example, this is financial heuristics, some work that Antoinette Shore did to show that with microloans to entrepreneurs, you really need to boil down the education to some very simple rules of thumb. And we're now in India piloting, using that same insight, but then turning it into actually technology with text messaging and IVR messages. College completion services. We now know a lot about what makes kids successful and what behavioral levers we can try out. Soon, Alicia Fishbane from Ideas 42 will be publishing the report that shows the 15 studies. And you can imagine combining those things together and then selling it to universities. And then lastly, just think about replication. This is a very simple intervention we did around FAFSA re-enrollment and at Arizona State University. It's simple enough where people can just look at the letters that we redesigned, the chunking methodology, and they could do it themselves. Okay, great. Thank you.
Right, thanks very much. I'll crack on. My name is Stefan Hunt, and I work for the Financial Conduct Authority in the UK. So for those of you who haven't heard of us, we're the equivalent of the US's CFPB, Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, but also the equivalent of the US's SEC, CFTC, FINRA, all the insurance commissions, parts of the Department of Justice, and more. So we have a very wide remit across retail and institutional financial markets. We also have competition powers as well as consumer protection and powers and objectives. So that's actually quite important for regulating markets. So luckily, I think this slide, Josh has already done my job for me, and many of you will also be aware of the large literatures in retail finance. But why is behavioral science particularly useful? So people often find financial products very complex. They often involve risk and uncertainty, which is things that people struggle with. There's intertemporal trade-offs, such as with savings products or with loan products. And people find it very difficult to make those trade-offs. They often involve emotions, for example, like stress and anxiety and regret, which can make decisions very hard. And there's a bunch of other reasons as well. It seems with financial products, you can measure things very well. And of course, they're financial, so we can get numerical estimates of things. But actually, I'll also come back to the question of measurement as well. And lastly, as Josh has definitely done this already, it's like the vast array of studies that already exist in retail finance is quite wide. So given the remit that we have and the large body of knowledge, we want to see how we could apply this to regulating, especially retail financial markets in the UK. So the first thing that we wanted to do was really understand the existing literature. And there was three reasons why we wanted to do this. So first was really to train up people in the organization so that they knew what already existed. Secondly was so that we could develop kind of a processes and a framework internally. But third was also that we could kind of convey that to the consumer groups and the firms that we regulate. So the as you can see on the right-hand side, you've got a little, this is a little supply-demand chart. So we have to think there's a whole bunch of ways that actual demand might differ from true demand, and there's a wide variety of sources. I'm not going to go into that here, but that's what we did in this paper. So you can see there's an actual demand curve and a true demand curve. But also, and very, very importantly, when you're regulating markets, and this is very different to a lot of what we've heard over the last day and a half, is that the supply side is important. You've got to think about supply side responses to what you do. You've got to think about equilibrium, and that can really change things. We have to understand the situations in which the market might actually tend to take away bias and de-bias, or the situations that tend to might compound as well. So that gets very important. Again, I'm not going to cover that today, but those are significant issues. So we then wanted to think about how we could move forward and do original empirics. I'm going to try and give some examples over the next few slides, but just to give you an overview. So first of all, we're really trying to think about field trials. Really want to try and think about what works. And that's very important in the financial services context, because a lot of the decisions people will be making when they've got so many other demands on themselves at the same time. You've got to think, is there really going to be external validity from, say, lab trials or from other ways of doing things? And I think the real message here is learning by doing, and I'll come back to that. So you also got to think about lab experiments as well. There's many reasons why lab experiments might be useful as well. There's a whole bunch of ways that you can assess things. You also might not be able to go forward and do field trials as well. In our case, we need to persuade firms to work with us, and they may not be willing to work with us. Lastly, and very importantly, given that you've got markets and there's a lot of experimentation already going on, you want to think about natural experiments. What can we learn from what's already happening in the market as well? And that's particularly important as well when you try and think about these supply-side responses, because you're not going to get supply-side responses from looking at field trials. So I'll try and give some examples in the time I have. So the first thing, we want to try something very, very simple. So we did a letters trial. And I would certainly recommend starting with something as simple as this. So this is a case where people in the UK, the way the legal framework works, it, often in financial compensation cases, the firm has to write to the individuals, and individuals have to actually say that they feel they were missold to. So we are working with an insurance firm, and there's small ticket insurance, and there's a whole bunch of things we tried on the letters that they sent out. So the first thing was putting on the logo of our authority, or actually the previous incarnation. We tried putting these two salient bullets at the top. We tried removing some marketing blah, blah, blah that they'd put in the middle. We tried actually just being clear, it's only going to take 5 minutes. And then we tried putting the CEO's signature. And we also tried a couple of other things as well, changing the envelope and having reminders. So the base response rate was very, very small, 1.5%. But even with these relatively small and modest things we do, the bullets alone quadrupled the response rate. Simplifying, so moving the blah, 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 or just saying it's only going to take 5 minutes, almost doubled the response rate. And together, these were almost completely additive. And by the way, the FSA logo, almost completely zero effect, and the CEO signature, negative effect. But we found overall that we moved from £64,000 to over £500,000 in terms of redress, just from this one So we want to try and think about applying that to policy. So we want to try and look at savings products, where the issue is that you have teaser rates in savings, people end up on very low rates and they may not switch away. So we tried to do another RCT. We actually tried a bunch of different framing things. They truthfully didn't seem to work very much, but the real thing we learned was it seemed to be a reminder effect. Now that we've built up the capability we've actually put into the policy process, we're really trying to go more ambitious and think about other more pressing problems, such as the repayment of credit card debt, and how can we change the way minimum repayments are set up so that people can repay faster. Or in checking accounts, how do we reduce overdrafting or help people switch? So you also try and think about natural experiments as well. So here's an example where we looked at payday lending. We were forced to put a price cap. The Parliament put a duty upon us to impose a price cap. We had to understand the impacts of payday lending. So actually, loans turn out to be pretty similar in terms of size, duration, and cost as the US. In the case, in 2012, 2013, 10% of the adult population had applied for a payday loan in the UK. So we used our legal powers to force all the firms to give us their data, and we could match the same individuals across the firms. And for a large percentage, about 90% of the market, we had all of the denied applicants and fully disaggregated revenues and costs at the loan level, and lots information. We also did a survey on top of this as well. So we could actually measure using regression discontinuity, which is an empirical technique which effectively allows us to give us treatment and control groups just like RCTs. And we could measure the causal impact of payday loan use and track the month-by-month effect on people's credit bureau files, because we got the full 4.6 million credit bureau files using our legal powers as well. And we could track month by month what people happened. And you can see that in the month that people took out their payday loan, the chance of having of overdrafting went down 1% on a base of about 25%, which actually, you know, you'd hope they just got a slug of money in their account. But by 3 months afterwards, and persistently for the full year afterwards, 3 to 4% more likely to have used payday loans. So obviously, there's a whole bunch of other results as well. It turns out people increase borrowing if they don't get paid, formal borrowing if they don't get payday loans. They start missing payments on non-payday products. Their credit scores go down 20 points. So over, we did the survey as well. We did the survey around the discontinuity. And we found that if there was no payday loan, most people actually just went without. The most popular other thing too was borrowing from friends and family. We found no effect on loan start use, no impact on subjective well-being, financial distress. We also held a bunch of other questions as well, such as regret and these kind of things, and allowed us to paint a picture of what we thought was happening to welfare. And overall, it looks like people are worse off on the margin from taking out payday loans. So there's almost 10 studies that we've done since 2013. So where do we come to from that? So the first thing is, it's kind of dull, but it's very, very important to think about quality assurance. You've got to think about the processes, get them right. We've learned a lot by doing, but now we need to systematize that and make sure that we can understand, we can fit in the rest of the organization. So there's a whole bunch of things you need to do here. And organizations like Innovations for Poverty Action, the Poverty Action Lab, I'm sure Ideas 42 as well, have really, really probably at the forefront of thinking about these kind of issues. They're very important. We also have to think about the incentives of firms to participate with us. It cannot be that the firms, by their participation or not at all, or particular treatments or not at all, can bias how we might come out with our our rules and our regulations. We have to think about that very carefully, and we do. So consolidating and building the research network has been very important. We try to work with an academic in each of our studies, because we actually find that we get some really good ideas, creativity of treatments, or even with survey questions, and these kind of things can be very useful. So there's a whole bunch of theory and methods that you might want to use. We also find I'm primarily an economist, and we want to reach out beyond economics as well to psychologists, to people from other disciplines, and this really helps. So in the public sector, you're always dealing with very limited resource. So actually, this helps us leverage our resource as well. And over time, you're learning how to really create shared incentives, which can be very tricky because fundamentally we have different goals to academics. So in terms of sharing lessons, we've both been working domestically. There's a UK competition network and a sister authority of competition markets, so they to help train other people up. There's so much learning from others, of course, in doing this. And the two-way interaction with the Behavioural Insights team as well, where we learn from them, they learn from us. Internationally, there's the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau have got some great economists and psychologists as well. So actually going there, hearing from them and then hearing from us and understanding what we might do differently. We also run, we're vice chair of the G20 OECD Task Force on Financial Consumer Protection, and we won this major work stream. We're trying to pull together the financial regulators from around the world and understand what can be done. What's the way forward? So in terms of using behavioural insights, so the way that the policy process works in the UK is that there's a wide variety of actors involved, and we would normally be quite downstream at the end. We'd be waiting for kind of remedies to come to us, and we'd have some involvement, but maybe not so much. And over time, we've really realised if we really want to have impact, we need to be far more involved upstream in making sure that psychology is being considered right from the beginning when we're understanding the kind of failures and, of course, the behavioural market failures that might exist. In terms of the downstream policy design, we want to think about getting more creative and getting bolder in terms of what we've been able to do. A lot of the things that we've tried have been maybe not quite so bold and haven't always had as strong results as you'd like, and now that we've got the capabilities, we want to take them further. And very importantly, and this is a new line of work for us, we're just trying to make sure within more specific areas of the organization, let's make sure that we really understand what already exists. So with advertising and marketing, do we already know the literature's out there? And are we making sure that our financial promotions team is fully abreast of that literature and is able to put it into the tools that they use and many other parts of the organization, so the activities of the organization are behaviorally informed? There's a bunch of technical challenges too. So one is selecting the optimal methods. And this is a lot based on the fact that we're resource constrained the whole time. We cannot do and we should not do RCTs for every single thing. And we can't, there's lots of decisions we need to make. So we need to think about field trials, lab trials, natural experiments, but also maybe other less rigorous methods as well. We need to think about preferences. So in the payday example, that's probably the best example we've done of really trying to think about effectively a structural model of welfare and how can we get information that helps us really understand the errors. But this is very difficult, and I'm looking forward to Hunt's talk, where I think you're going to be touching on some of the, getting some of the costs of time and effort into thinking about things. Getting trials into cost-benefit analysis is very tricky. We've got to start thinking about external validity. How do we really understand what's going to be true? And in particular, these equilibrium effects, when you've got supply-side responses, how do we know that in the RCT, the results are going to come over? And lastly, we really want to use all of the above that I've just covered and really try and think about tackling some very thorny issues like switching. And switching is something that we're finding very hard to really get people moving on very much. Thank you.
My name's Marianne O'Loughlin. I'm the Deputy Secretary, New South Wales Department of Premier and Cabinet. To give you a bit of perspective, in case you're not au fait with New South Wales, we're about the population size of Massachusetts, 7.5 million people, but we're about this much bigger, scaled up in terms of size. I advise the Premier on all social policy issues, so I take the behavioural insights approach to social policy issues. And though that includes education, health, justice, and welfare policy, I'm very fortunate that I have the New South Wales Behavioural Insights Unit in my group, and Shabnam Gill, who's sitting over here. She's from the unit, and she's joining me at the conference. Our unit was established in 2012, so we are the first in Australia. We've got a multidisciplinary team of 11 people, and we're supported by advice from the Australian branch of the UK BIT. Our primary focus is working with other government agencies to develop interventions to improve policy. And we work across all portfolio areas. So we work health, education, transport, justice and the environment. We work with the agencies and we to develop and then run trials with them. So what I'm going to look at today is our experience in scaling up as we've moved and developed our behavioural approaches from more simple to more complex policy problems. So let's begin at the beginning, and like most BI teams, I guess, we started applying behavioural insights in simple ways, such as changing the way government communicates, particularly in things like paying taxes, fines, going to medical appointments. So we think we're quite adept at that and how that works. But we have a really interesting example of, I think, why it's so interesting. It's a very simple nudge, but actually the policy impact is more than simple, if I can put it that way. What we did was we have call it social housing, so it's people in government housing and people who are behind in their rent. So we had an example, a trial of sending text messages to people to remind them to pay their rent. It was very, very successful. We also trialled a number of different approaches and found that sending different proven messages to the same person was more effective than one message and more effective than the same message twice. So although, as I say, that's pretty simple and it's an extremely inexpensive policy to implement, but not only does the government recover unpaid rent, which is great for the government, but the person or the family avoids eviction, which is a really significant impact. Next, we moved into trialling more complex behavioural interventions. And a good example here was we were supporting injured workers to return to work faster. And this was built on the UK BIT experience of getting people on welfare back to work. We ran a trial with the Department of Education and their insurer, Allianz, to better support injured teachers to get back to work. Now, getting back to work in a shorter period of time is a better outcome for the workers, both in terms of their well-being and obviously also in terms of their income. We looked at the system that was in existence and there were a lot of problems with it. And they were working against a swift return to work. There were a lot of really hard to understand written communications, pages and pages and pages. Injured workers were very passive in the process, and the insurance company's caseworkers were driven by compliance and process instead of outcomes. So we trialled a number of interventions. We focused on reducing and simplifying communications, which was a really important part of it. But we also more positively framed the messages around health, return to work, rather than before it was all about injury management. And also the injured workers took a much more proactive role in their recovery, including we got them to make a plan and think through the stages for helping them get better. The trial was a success, and the intervention group got back to work 27% faster than the control group within a 90-day period, and important differences emerged from about 7 days, so very early on. It also had a very positive effect on job satisfaction for the caseworkers. They enjoyed the much less compliance-driven approach, and of course there were savings to the insurer. So the insurer Allianz was so pleased with the results that they now scaled up that successful intervention across its entire business. The return to work trial was an example of scaling up across a single system of the insurance company. With the BI unit, we are now working on, in, as well, more complex policy problems, which span much broader contexts, such as childhood obesity, child protection, and domestic violence. And today I'm going to focus on domestic violence, which is an all too common crime in New South Wales, as across Australia. Our work here, we're still developing our work, so we've yet to implement it, although this year we're going to be implementing our interventions, but we've done a lot of the research and development. But so what we're aimed at in the project is reducing domestic violence reoffending. So the best available data is about there's a 15% rate of reoffending within 12 months. The data also shows that reoffending occurs very quickly after a defendant has first been charged, 7% within 24 hours, 20% within 2 weeks, and more than 50% before the court hearing and before the court orders are finalised. And that takes on about an average of 4 months. But currently, most domestic violence interventions are actually at the back end, after the court hearing, so 4 months or more down the track. So in the BI unit, we're working on earlier interventions to reduce that reoffending. And here we're targeting three goals. The first goal is to improve the offender's compliance with what in Australia are called apprehended domestic violence orders, or ADVOs. So these orders are usually made when a person is first charged with a domestic violence offence. So long before they've gone to court, they're put on an order. That order puts strict conditions on how and where a defendant can contact a victim. For the majority of the victims, the court orders are really effective in reducing, eliminating negative behaviours such as physical assault, stalking, verbal abuse, intimidation. But breaches are very common. So we're trialling a number of ways to increase compliance. The first thing we did was translate the current court orders into plain English. They are extremely difficult to understand. A readability test showed that to understand the current court orders, the reader needed to have about 13 and a half years of education. Our new orders, which we're going to implement later this year, will require about 8 years of education, and so easily understood for an example of 13 to 15-year-olds. But we're moving beyond just simplifying the court orders to include behavioural messages on the court orders to challenge the normalisation of violence in some communities. We also found in our field work that highlighting the impact on their children had a significant impact on some offenders. So I'm just going to illustrate an example of the new message on a domestic violence court order. I'll read you one. It says, "Most relationships do not include fear, control, or violence. You are now part of a minority of people who has one of these orders, and this is recorded on the New South Wales police system. When children are exposed to violence in the home, they are much more likely to suffer from depression, anxiety, and aggression, and they do worse at school. Many people take this as the turning point." And then we give some contact numbers for people to call if they want to follow that up. We're also going to be testing commitment devices for offenders who have been served with court orders to try and increase compliance, make a plan intervention to trial the effect of individual meetings to assist defendants to think through the plan for complying with the court orders. For example, we know a lot of the violence happens with alcohol. So we say, if you're going to go and drink after work, think through, can you go and before you go drinking and arrange to stay at a friend's place that night. Our second goal to reduce reoffending is ensuring attendance by offenders at court. About 30% of offenders don't show up at court, and the fieldwork showed that victims suffer additional stress and anxiety when they don't attend their court dates. There's also increased risk to the victim when the court order is not physically served on the offender, as well as the potential for an increase in breaches, as the offender may not understand all the conditions of the order. So a simple nudge to increase court attendance can have actually much more significant spin-offs because the offender gets more engaged in the full court system. So we're running a 6 to 12 month text trial to test whether sending personalised SMS reminders about court dates and times will increase offenders showing up to court. Our third goal to reduce reoffending comes into the more complex behavioural interventions. We're developing and piloting a group-based early intervention workshop for medium-risk offenders aimed at ensuring they understand the impact of domestic violence and their responsibility for their behaviour and consider ways to change. But the focus is on a fairly brief and early intervention as soon as possible after the offence. That is, we're thinking about hours, days, not weeks or months, which is what it's been more recently. It might in fact be a complementary service, so we have an early intervention very soon after they've been charged, follow it up down the track with a more intensive intervention. So what we're thinking at the moment would be similar to what they a program in the UK, which is called the Domestic Abuse Awareness Raising Course. It consists of a much shorter program than classic behavioural change programs. It has 2 4-hour workshops with a 1 month reflection period between sessions. An evaluation of that program found that the people attending the course were 46% less likely to reoffend than a comparison sample of offenders who did not attend. I'd just like to conclude my talk today with some, these are very personal reflections because, as I say, the Behavioural Insight Unit, I'm lucky it's in my area, but I'm not the one that runs all these trials. I'm just lucky enough to be working with the team. But I want to come at it from a perspective of a public policy practitioner, and I underline that very strongly. People may know, most people in this room have heard of Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan, and he was a great social policy legislator in the US. He was a US senator for 35 years. Senator Moynihan once said, "If you don't have 30 years to devote to social policy, don't get involved." Now, the thing is, when I thought about this quote, I have devoted 30 years to social policy. And when I think about this period, I can think of great things we've done. We've put some great social policies, enabling policy, access to services. We have universal health care, great childcare access. We have great increase in children going to end of school. Macro policies, we've really done it really well. But I'm really despondent about how ineffectual social policy has been in addressing some critical problems. So in Australia, as a nation, we've had 25 years of economic and employment growth. We dodged the Great Recession. And we've increased constantly already significant investment in all manner of social programs. But we still have Australians in entrenched economic and social disadvantage, and we still face the relentless problems of domestic violence and child abuse. Recently, David Halpin wrote about behavioural science. Ultimately, our ambition should be more than about scale. It's about impact. It's time for us to move beyond getting taxes paid on time and getting people to the gym, important though these are. It's time to challenge the behavioural science community to take on some of the biggest and seemingly intractable challenges of our time. Behavioural science is helping us take on domestic violence. I went through the things we're doing. But recall that these interventions are aimed at reducing reoffending. The damage is already being done. The harder questions taunt us, such as how to prevent it in the first place. We must, if you like, nudge upstream in policy terms. We must get closer to the source of the problem. But moving upstream ratchets up the degree of difficulty. Our sphere of influence becomes less direct. We have less control over how our interventions will work in context. The contexts are messy and confronting. Our hands are less securely on the levers of change as we face entrenched problems of drug and alcohol abuse, mental illness, intergenerational trauma, and chronic poverty. As someone who's been involved in social policy for 30 years, who's kind of haunted, to be honest, by collective failure in this area, I do look to the promise of behavioural science. This conference brings together unique strengths of academics and policymakers. So my question to this audience is, can behavioural science provide the foundations to help us build the policy responses to these seemingly intractable problems? Thank you.
That, but I do need the clicker. Perfect. Thank you very much. Thanks, Tricia. Do you want to try this? Fantastic. Well, thanks very much. My name is Hunt Allcott. I'm a professor at New York University in the economics department. I am also affiliated with Ideas 42 and Poverty Action Lab and some other folks that you see on this slide. And I wanted to come and talk about cost-benefit analysis for nudges. And just to fix ideas about why this is important, imagine a thought experiment. You've got $1 billion in societal resources. Should you develop a wind farm? Should you send home energy reports? Should you run a public health education campaign? Should you fund retirement savings? Should you do something else? And to answer this sort of question, you want to compare benefits and costs. You want to ask, how do I get the most societal benefit for your $1 billion? And so this is, I think, one of the core questions that you'd want to ask in a session on smart scaling. Before we scale something up, we want to do the cost-benefit analysis. Now, the problem is that benefit-cost analysis with nudges is particularly hard. And so instead of doing a full cost-benefit analysis, what we often do is what I yesterday called a cost-effectiveness heuristic. So in other words, we'll maximize behavior change per dollar of implementation cost. We'll take a behavior maximization approach as opposed to a welfare maximization approach. So the sort of logic that you see sometimes is intervention X caused large behavior change and was cheap to implement, and so policymakers should broadly adopt it. So here are the categories of problems that this sort of logic generates. First, it doesn't attempt to actually quantify the benefits and costs of the behavior change. So I'll give you a controversial, but I think very real example. When you nudge people to smoke less, people lose the pleasure of smoking. If the pleasure of smoking is very, very small, then there's a huge benefit to having people quit smoking. On the other hand, if there's some larger pleasure of smoking, then when we get people to quit smoking, the net benefits are going to be much smaller. A second category of problems with my behavior change cost-effectiveness heuristic is it ignores any direct impacts of the nudge itself. So if I send reminders, are my reminders annoying? Or to come back to another controversial cigarette example, if I have graphic cigarette warning labels, are those aversive? Is it, in some sense, reducing my utility just by seeing the warning labels? A third category of problems is that it becomes very difficult to compare across outcomes. So let's say I've got a great intervention that helps people to quit smoking, and I've got another great intervention that helps people to save energy. How do I decide if I have limited resources, which one of those to focus on? As another example, how do I compare an intervention that generates 3 trips to the gym per dollar versus another intervention that generates 40 gallons of water saved per dollar? So what I want to do now is go into a particular example, a paper that I wrote with Judd Kessler from Wharton, who's a great guy. Some of you guys know him. And we took home energy reports as a case study introducing a new way of doing cost-benefit analysis for nudges. And so I think many of you guys know what home energy reports are. The core thing is what you see at the top of this graph, or top of this page here. You send letters to residential electricity or gas consumers, and you compare their energy use to that of their neighbors. So this person is doing slightly better in the sense of slightly less energy use than his average neighbor there in the all neighbors bar. But he's not quite as efficient as his quote-unquote efficient neighbors, which is the 20th percentile of his neighbor comparison group. So we got a smiley face. The letters are trying to convey that more savings, more conservation is good. So I mentioned a slide ago this cost-effectiveness heuristic. And I want to introduce how it's been used in this context and why it's why it misses some important things. Now, I'm going to argue that this is wrong, and so I don't want to name any names, but I'm going to take a slide from a paper written by someone in the Journal of Public Economics. And what this someone, unnamed person, did is he or she looked at the first 17 O-Power programs, which are named with codes here, the first 17 O-Power programs, and stacked up the cost effectiveness of each program in cents of program implementation cost per kilowatt hour of electricity saved. And so these are all in the 2 to 3 to 4 cents per kilowatt hour saved. And that turns out by this cost effectiveness standard is very highly cost effective. I'm going to argue that this person was missing a lot of things with this approach. And just to be clear, it wasn't just this Allcott guy. Lots of nudges are analyzed in this sort of way. So if I have a nutrition improvement program, I can say, well, or a smoking cessation program, I got 500 people to quit, and it cost me $1,000 or $20,000 in program implementation costs. And those are the sorts of statistics you see a lot. Okay, in this context, what's wrong with that? We're missing at least four categories of costs. The first is if the savings were generated through making a physical capital investment. So I saved energy because I bought a new air conditioner. That costs money. Second is time cost. So I'm saving energy because I'm turning off the lights or adjusting the thermostat or remembering my mom used to walk around the house every night and unplug all the appliances, which can save energy but took her time. Third is changes in comfort. So as I'm adjusting the thermostat, I'm living in a hotter room or a hotter house in the summer. And the fourth category is emotional benefits and costs. So I might be inspired to conserve energy, or I might be guilted into conserving energy. And that could be a positive or negative utility effect. And what I want you to see is these are very real. They're generating the savings. Nowhere do they enter this picture. Right, because this is tallying up cents of program implementation cost per kilowatt hour saved. So these could be really large costs. Some of these could be positive benefits, not going into the cost effectiveness heuristic calculation. And now those of you who don't work in energy can think about with the cost effectiveness heuristics that are being used in the nutrition or smoking or health or other contexts, what's being missed. So with Judd Kessler, I worked on an experiment that attempts to incorporate some of these costs. And let me give you the basic intuition for what we were trying to do. We wanted to use willingness to pay, to be nudged, as a metric of as a holistic measure of how much consumers value the nudge. So the idea is, I'm going to send Stefan 4 home energy reports, and then I'm going to ask Stefan, we can send you 4 more. You know what they're like. How much are you willing to pay to continue to receive these? And then Stefan's going to give us some number, and we're going to take that seriously for cost-benefit analysis. And in particular, we're going to have in mind that Stefan's calculation about what he's willing to pay for these home energy reports includes the value of energy savings, but also the effort, you know, that he's going to put into saving energy, whether he might get information about an air conditioner or buy a new air conditioner, how much he likes the home energy reports, all of these things. This is going to be a controversial assumption. You might imagine lots of reasons why willingness to pay might not be a full measure of consumer surplus. And so that's one of the costs of taking this approach. Our view was, at least in the O-Power context, that this was a reasonable design. So here's what we did. Again, we sent people 4 home energy reports in the heating season of 2014-2015. This was in partnership with O-Power and a utility called Central Hudson Gas and Electric in New York. After the fourth report, we asked people how much they were willing to pay to continue to receive home energy reports via a survey that looks like this. It says, tell us what you think. We've been sending you home energy reports. Fill out this survey below. Here's what the survey says. Question 4 is one to focus on first. It says, which would you prefer, 4 home energy reports plus a $10 check or just a $10 check? And so if you value these at any positive amount, you would choose on the left here. The last question is, which would you prefer, 4 more home energy reports plus a $1 check or a $10 check? So here, if you're going to choose home energy reports, you need to really like them because you're giving up $9. At the top, which would you prefer, 4 more home energy reports plus a $10 check or a $1 check? So if you're choosing a $1 check, you're telling us that you're giving up $9 to avoid being nudged. We're allowing you to have negative willingness to pay for these. So here's what we find. This is the distribution of willingness to pay for those next 4 home energy reports in terms of percent of respondents in this New York, upstate New York population. About 30-some percent of these guys are weakly negative. The rest are weakly positive. I want to build on 2 features of this graph. First is there's a lot of dispersion. Some people love this. A few people really hate this. The second is the average of this is about $3. And so let me start with that $3 observation. And so this means that on average, consumers are getting $3 of value from the home energy reports. Now let's put this into a welfare calculation, a full benefit cost analysis. There are 4 parts of the benefit cost analysis for these home energy reports. And I'm putting this in dollars per household for the next 4 reports. Over here are 2 benefits, and over here are 2 costs. The first benefit is the benefit that consumers perceive. And I told you that this was $3. This is the average willingness to pay. But that's only one part of the calculation. The other part is, well, we're saving energy. And energy generates negative externalities. It generates climate change. And so when I save energy, I'm reducing that. And that's valued at about $2 in terms of the average savings that we'll see. Over here is the implementation cost. It's about $2. Right about $2 a household, and it's mostly just to print and send letters. And finally is the utility net revenue loss. It turns out that utilities have a retail markup to help recover fixed costs. And so when I conserve, I actually reduce my utility's ability to cover fixed costs. That's got to be made up somehow. And so you can see that in this particular case, this is what the full benefit cost analysis works out to. The final observation, I mentioned that this is very highly dispersed. Great. This is very highly dispersed. And so you might say, well, is there a way that we could target better, to target the home energy reports to people who like them and not send them to people who don't? And maybe we could do a lot better. Let me just show you 2 ways of doing that. The first is that you could run an opt-in program. If you like it, you opt in. If you don't like it, you don't take it. What I'm showing here on the left axis is the total welfare gain in red bars and the share treated, which are these blue dots. This is the existing program. There are about $7,000 in welfare gains from the second year of the Home Energy Report program across this full population with 50% treated. It was randomly assigned 50% treatment, 50% control. So now let me come back to this opt-in program. The problem with opt-in program is that defaults are very, very sticky. And so if the default is you're not receiving home energy reports, very few people sign up. And so we expect that about 1-2% of people would sign up. Even if you make very generous assumptions that the highest willingness to pay people would sign up, you still can't get the welfare gain that you get from blanketing the population. This final bar considers smart targeting. And so what we're doing is we're using consumer demographics, income, education, whether you're a renter or a homeowner, to predict these data. And when we do that, we drop about 16% of the treatment group or 8% of the population. And we're basically dropping people that hate it. When we do that, we can increase the total welfare gains in the population. So what I want to leave you with then are 2 ideas. First is it matters a lot to do cost-benefit analysis and to try to capture these things that are not being captured in the cost-effectiveness heuristic. And second, once you do that, you can better target to maximize social welfare gains. Thanks very much. And so what we'll do now is we'll bring our panelists up here, and we will take questions from the audience. And so if you'd like to ask a question, just raise your hand, and I will organize things, and I'll call on folks. Please, up in the back.
Question is for you. So in the intervention where you were giving multiple options of reports and a combination of different monetary benefits, did you randomize the ordering? Because when we do financial choice experiments, the options at the bottom, when it's a complex choice, are dominated by the top because people have fatigue going through options.
Yeah, so great question. So there are actually a number of concerns that you might have about the way the willingness to pay elicitation was done. So one is the ordering. A second is what are the largest and smallest numbers, and that generates some anchoring effects. There's a new paper by Leibson and co-authors. Maybe that's you. And a series of additional effects. One of the things that makes us a bit more confident in these are all worries, and we actually sent only one version of that survey. So in principle, you might be worried about that. One of the things that generates additional confidence for us is that we also did a phone survey, and there are some households that actually answered both on the phone and via paper, probably because it was the husband that answered one and the wife that answered the other. And so do you expect these to be correlated, not necessarily the same? What we see there is the average responses for those two are statistically and economically very similar, and the phone survey design was very different. And so that alleviates some of the concerns that you'd have. That said, in the big picture, there are a whole bunch of concerns you'd have about a willingness to pay approach, and so I view this as only a first step. Other questions? Yes, please.
So the question is for Stefan Hunt. When you were talking about moving the way forward, you mentioned that one of the technical challenges was modeling errors and incorporating cost of time and effort. Would you care to elaborate, please?
Sure. I this definitely relates to what Hum was talking about as well. The time costs and effort costs. I mean, we've done some. We have certainly incorporated these in a couple of our studies. We've asked simple questions like how much would it take to show up, and we asked a whole variety of questions to get at this. But actually, there's a whole bunch of other reasons, as Hunt alluded to, that may not really help us just get at that. Secondly, and very, and that's just one specific thing. More generally, we've just got to try and think about preferences and what would people really want to do, right? So with the payday lending, we actually really want to try and get an overall sense of welfare, an overall sense of whether people are better off or worse off. And there's no a priori way of judging that. So we need some implicit or explicit model of what's going on. In this case, we didn't try and, we couldn't in this particular setting pin down something. We had a whole bunch of potential models in mind. We asked lots of questions to try to really get a sense of welfare. And this is just really important, especially when people are making choices in markets. You just really don't know what's right for people. So take the credit card repayment option. What's the right level of repayment for people? We wouldn't want to be nudging people so that they're paying back their credit cards too fast. They may be harming them in other ways. So we have to take a sort of a rounded view of behavioral welfare economics, basically.
Stefan, can I follow up on that? So in your empirical results show that there are negative impacts on average of taking up payday loans. And so what do you think is the model that explains why people are signing up for payday loans despite the negative impacts? Is it present bias or is it something else?
So I think it might be. So we totally have not been able to pin that down exactly. One of the things in the UK is that certainly at the time that we did the work, 80 to 90% of the market was online. It's now 95% plus. So it's actually quite different to the US. It's very easy to get the loans, right? You get it on your mobile phone. You can get the money within 15 minutes. If we look actually through the week, we see the spike in demand on Friday afternoons, the lull on Sundays, which actually could have some rational reasons, but there's lots of things that sort of make you suggest there might be some impulsive behavior. We also see quite a lot, why I didn't show was we see quite a lot of regret. I think the regret was around 40% or so. Really, really interesting though, the people who use payday loans more regretted using payday loans more. So that looks similar to potentially like addictive behavior, which might be present biased, but I often think of present bias as a reduced form way of thinking that there's a whole bunch of things behind that could be causing it. And to be honest, we don't know.
I mean, I would just add for the cause part, I think Sendhil and Eldar's book on scarcity and how the cognitive bandwidth issues when you're operating under scarcity, as well as the tunneling effect, which exacerbates present bias, and the book does some studies actually with students and replacing money with time in a game and being able to borrow from the future, which suggests this kind of tunneling and the exacerbation of present bias is a big cause for the payday loan taking, even though when you look overall, they regret later or there is harm.
Can you, Stefan, paint a sort of quick sketch of how you would go from a research finding that on average payday loans are bad to a policy recommendation?
This was a very specific setting. We had a duty placed upon us in primary legislation. We had to impose a price cap. So that the intervention was determined for us, to be clear. Mm. So in this case, we had to impose a price cap. The question was how tight to do it, and obviously the structure. There's lots of different aspects to price. How do we do that? So we used this. So I've only showed the demand side. We actually had the actually harder piece of the work was doing the supply side modeling. So we actually literally modeled. Turns out they think about expected customer lifetime profitability. The chance of coming back is so much that firms are willing to lend to people certainly in excess, and I can't say the specific amounts, but in excess of 50% chance of defaulting on that first payday loan. Now, they're going to take massive losses on that. And the reason they're willing to do that is because people are coming back over time, right? Mm-hmm. So you have to be able to model expected customer lifetime profitability. So once you do that, we've got the supply side model, the demand side model. You just try and build up all the different costs and benefits, and you try and look at for different kinds of structures of the price cap and different kind of levels. Taking account that you might have other effects as well, how tight did we want to go? We literally, we decided on a structure for a bunch of reasons, and then we literally had the full scale. We had estimated costs and benefits for all the different, and then we decided how tight we wanted to go. Mm. And in this case, it was the supply side modeling, and there was some extra stuff where we tried to think about supply side responses as well. The real concern was that if we tightened it more than we did, we actually just might see almost complete exit in the market. There might be down to two or three firms. And certainly as an initial step, we didn't want to do that. And so what we did, we made it bind considerably, but then we actually then committed to review it. And we actually got a review process coming up for the price cap as well.
Very interesting.
Could I just add one thing?
Yes, please.
Just because the CFPB has gone through a similar process here in the U.S. They did similar research, although different in looking at the data. Did look and see that people repeat and take payday loans out over and over again, and then credit scores fall, and there's detrimental. And they now, if you wanted to see an alternative approach, and I'm not saying one approach is better than the other, because I think the CFPB's approach has some challenges also. But they now have a proposed rule out there, and their approach has much more been, the heaviest part of it is that there's going to be an underwriting process, basically. The financial institution or financial entity has to make sure that the person has the ability to repay. And the conjecture is that that basically will be too costly for most of the entities to do, and it will basically shut down payday loans in the U.S. But, so it's just an alternative approach. I'm not sure. I don't have a say on which one's better or worse.
The CFPB is specifically disallowed from putting price caps, by the way, so yeah. They only say it's compliant.
Yeah. Great, yes.
When you all are creating programs that are meant to be scaled, how much are you considering either culture, social identity, and inherent people's values when you think about either sustainability programs or also preventative programs?
Given the areas that I touched on today, we're really at the very beginning. And it, you could tell by the examples I gave, they were very simple nudges in some ways. And the example of the domestic violence one, again, it's very focused on the court system, and it's focused on preventing reoffending. Now, that's quite a small slice of the domestic violence world. It's a slice of the world that's in government's hands, if you know what I mean. So it's once we move out of that and you raise the enormous complexities of context, which people have been talking about more today. And I also think that the complexity of the different variables in play in those areas. And for my sense of it is, it goes back to a point that was made, I think, by Josh, is that decision about whether you go bottom-up or top-down, my sense of this world is that we need to understand the world an awful lot more, and big data here helps us because we can use administrative data to understand the population and to understand their use of health services, education, welfare, transport, all manner of things. And beyond that, to be honest, that's sort of relatively easy for government. But the other thing that I think understanding in the sort of complex areas I was talking about is the social physics idea of Pentland, where you're really trying to understand the social networks and in terms of the social norms, and you're trying to get changes in attitudes and understanding through the community. So and it's very much working bottom-up and I think peer-to-peer as well.
Yes, in the back.
So you've actually talked a lot about heterogeneity and diversity and let's say willingness to pay for a nudge. And I wonder if it seems somewhat ironically, well, I was wondering if you could talk about how scalable you think asking every household for the willingness to pay for a nudge is. And if you don't think that's scalable, then I was wondering if you could speak about possibility of using some kind of predictive modeling approach to personalize nudges for people. So Cassandra's team's written a lot about personalized defaults. And so I was just wondering what are your thoughts on that and whether you think people would be more open to personalized nudges or less open because maybe they feel it's more manipulative or paternalistic or something.
Sure, so there are two issues. The first is how do you think about evaluating an existing program? And one of the benefits of the cost effectiveness heuristic is that the outcome is energy saved, which is already measured by the utilities through the energy bills. And so when you want to do what we call the full benefit cost analysis, it can be very costly to do at the kind of scale that OPower does for the full for their full populations. And so we view this as sort of a proof of concept. If people took it seriously, they would then, do it for a subsample of a population. They'd do it in a few cities. That would be sort of how that scaling would go. In terms of targeting, that can be done, I think, as you suggest, again, with a small sample survey. Once you have enough of a sample that you have a sense that they're reliable predictions, that these types of people like being nudged, these types of people don't, then in principle you can, within the usual concerns about extrapolation, you can start to extrapolate those models elsewhere. Yes?
This is a more general question. I've heard some people who have been working with interventions say that while you're designing devising a prototype, you shouldn't worry about scaling yet. Otherwise, this might constrain your mind. What are your thoughts about that? It makes it harder later on.
I'm looking at Shabna, because actually Shabna does this work directly. But I mean, from my point of view, I think, and a lot of the issues that when I opened up at the end to those issues, I do think it's so bottom up, and I do think it's almost community to community. We, in Australia, for these sets of issues around chronic domestic violence and child abuse issues, it's a very community-based approach that seems to work best. So you could see some general principles and you could see some general ways of doing it,
But I think because my career, which I said in social policy of 30 years, has been an enormous failure in so many ways, and that's telling the truth, and it's true about social policy across the world, so I'm not alone. Our mistake was to go macro, bottom down, top down, and very much start to think that we had the answer, that we were going to spread across all of the people and all of the communities. And I think the big data has helped us enormously to see the variation. But I also think, sincerely, the coming onto the field in a policy way of behavioural sciences has helped us enormously as well, because it is much more of a bottom-up approach. So I guess I'd be worried about falling into the same trap that we fell in before about thinking that we could have the answer. I think it's much better to iterate as you go, try, test, learn.
Yeah, I'll add something briefly on that. So certainly from where we're at in terms of using trials, I would have thought, actually, the trials aren't used much in regulation. So that, we really need stuff that we can show is practical. Actually showing the utility is really, really important. So I certainly wouldn't trial anything that could not be implemented. If it's a policy-related project, I wouldn't try anything that couldn't be implemented in policy straight away. There just wouldn't be. It would be a bad thing for my unit. We'd lose, effectively, political capital by doing stuff that's not sufficiently practical.
I would actually separate the question for academics versus people who are trying to have an impact. So. Sorry, that came out wrong. But when you think about the primary purpose of academia, their primary goal is not to have a large impact at scale. That's not the primary goal, right? The primary goal is to find new foundational understandings about how humans behave. So I definitely would be very concerned about putting the lens of, hey, as an academic, I want you also to be thinking about how this thing ultimately gets to hundreds of thousands or millions of people. For the people who are trying to translate, take all that great work that the academics have done and try to get to the scale in a more consistent, systematic way, I think you have to hold both things in your mind. So part of the reason we've developed that five-path framework is that we want people, as they're developing the interventions, at least to be having that in mind. Now, it might be that in the prototype process, for cost reasons or feasibility reasons, you might come up with something that couldn't scale. For example, you think about Phil Oriopoulos's and Bridget Terry Long's test around providing help for people filling out the FAFSA. Now, they're academics, but they're not envisioning, I don't think, that all of a sudden the solution is that we should provide help to everybody to do the FAFSA necessarily. But the realization that the FAFSA and getting the mechanism right about what's causing people to be held back, you then realize, oh, maybe the federal government should take the tax data, fill out the FAFSA for people, and make it much simpler for people to fill out the FAFSA, not that we have to spend, $80 for each person to help them fill out the actual form.
I would just add that, as an academic, there are two reasons I've been interested in things that I think of as cheap and scalable. The first is that, if you do care about eventual scaling, then that's important. The second is that you care about sample size. And so, imagine working, think about the education context. You could work with brick and mortar schools, or you could work with MOOCs. There are lots of reasons why we care about what happens in brick and mortar schools, but the reality is that you can try lots of stuff all at once instantly in MOOCs. And so I think that plays a role in personally in my thought process in terms of what directions to try to go in. Let's take one more question. Yes, please.
Thinking about the Australian example, and looking up also upon what you were talking about the cost-benefit analysis, it would be really interesting next year to have you come back and have implemented something on the offended person's side too, so that we can measure the cost-benefit on working with the offender and working with the offended person.
It's an interesting point, because one of the when we talked about the domestic violence example, and a lot of the interesting things is the research that the behavioural insights unit does before we even get anywhere. it was really hard to do research with offenders. So to go and ask offenders, do you think this would work? Do you think this is, you know, to try and get their side of the story, not about the issue, but of course about the intervention. We did talk to their lawyers, and we did talk to sort of the court people around them, but it is an interesting point. I want to say one thing about cost-benefit analysis, though, when you say it in those rather clinical, here are the costs, here are the benefits, and, you know, A plus B and whatever. With government as well, though, there is there's another step before that, which is about the objectives. So government's always going to have trade-offs in objectives. And you absolutely, and I agree, and we really should do much more rigorous around what the costs are, what the benefits are, and much more better complicated ways than we're doing at the moment, which is quite simplistic around cost effectiveness. But nevertheless, if we've got... they won't give you the answer. Government has objectives that it wants to fulfil, and it's willing to trade off as well. So when you ask that question, I think for our point of view in policy, we back the thing we back up into, it's a government, you're duly elected, and they have objectives that they've said they'll fulfil.
Well, great. Well, thanks very much. Thank you all for coming, and let's thank our panelists.